Hello there, and welcome to this special interview with me, Franklin Tembo Jr. It has been 5 years since the Patriotic Front government came into power. Within this period, the party has already faced the electorate once in 2015, which ushered in President Edgar Lungu following the death of the PF founding president, Michael Sata, who died in 2014. During its campaigns that eventually ousted the MMD rule, the PF promised, among other things, to grow the economy, reduce the size of government, improve public service delivery, among other things. Since coming into power, the PF government has also taken some drastic measures, including removal of subsidies on petroleum products and engaged in some very ambitious projects. Has the PF government lived up to its promises? What are its failures? What are its successes? To answer these and more questions that we have on the program today, we have as our guests Dr. Chimba Kambwili, the Chief Government Spokesperson, and also holding the Office of Information and Broadcasting Services Minister. We hope that you'll be with us as we delve into various national issues. Thank you for coming to the program, and I hope you are feeling okay.
Thank you very much, Franklin, and good evening, viewers.
I know that it's a very busy period for you, like everybody else in this particular period. In a very brief sense, how are the campaigns going for you?
So far, so good. I think we've put up a very strong campaign. We've got a message that is sitting very well with the people. Like Guy Scott put it when he was acting president, he said it would be very easy for the PF to campaign in 2016. In case people don't know where our slogan of Sontapo came from, it actually came from Dr. Guy Scott when he said it would be very easy for the PF to campaign in 2016 because we'll only be pointing at our project. And true to Dr. Guy Scott's prediction, we are able to show what we've done as PF. And I think by and large, the people of Zambia are able to see what we've done. So the campaign has been going on very, very well.
Let's ride on that, because I want to know how, in your description, you feel your party has done since 2011.
Very well. Very well. PF has performed very, very well in the last 5 years, despite the fact that we've faced quite a number of challenges economically because of certain shocks that I can refer to as external shocks that we have very little control as a government. But in a nutshell, despite these challenges, we've performed very well. Because if you look at the economical growth that we've recorded since 2011 to 2015, and probably the emphasized economical growth for 2015, it will clearly show you that under very difficult circumstances, we've done very well. But having said that, we are not supernatural. In our quest to give the people of Zambia the best, we may have erred in one way or the other, because we are not supernatural. To err is human. Of course, we can't say that we've done things 100%. There may be certain areas where we lagged behind in the first 5 years, in which we need to pull our socks in the coming 5 years.
Right. Obviously, this is, I guess, a backdrop of what you have come across. Some citizens complaining that the cost of living has gone up. Life is not easy. Does that kind of reflect that perhaps you have failed to run the economy?
Franklin, when you complain without going to the basics, without getting into taking into consideration factors that are causing certain things to happen in the economy, you may say that the PF government has failed. But for those who are able to analyze and look at things in a more sensible way, they would know that what I've said is actually the fact that under very difficult circumstances, we've tried. First and foremost, when you talk about the high cost of living, you must ask yourself, what kind of economy do we run as Zambia? Zambia runs a mono economy, of which almost 70 to 80% of our export is copper. Copper is our foreign exchange earner in Zambia. And by the way, the MMD government in 1991, when they came into power, they destroyed the manufacturing base that we had in Zambia, meaning therefore that we depend on imports. Most of the things that we use in Zambia, be it food, be it clothing, machinery, is all imported in the country. Now, if you import everything that you use, almost everything that you use, when your exports reduce, obviously you are not attracting a lot of foreign exchange onto the market. If you don't attract a lot of foreign exchange onto your market, automatically your currency will depreciate. Once your currency depreciates, it simply means that things that you are ordering from outside using the little forex that is on the market, which has obviously gained value against your currency, it would mean you spend more kwacha in ordering what you were ordering before the currency depreciated at the current moment, meaning therefore that the cost of living has been upped because of the depreciation, in this case, of the kwacha.
Shouldn't you then have concentrated on bringing to life the local manufacturing industry? You've had this time to look at other options that are available to you or to the country in a sense of diversifying, sort of going with the copper that we all know is susceptible to changes. 5 years, surely you could have done something by now.
Frankly, it's easy said than done. Attracting investment is not a one-day thing. Attracting investment is not a one-year thing. Attracting investment is not a four-year thing. There are steps that you have to follow in attracting investments. We are doing everything possible to make sure that we bring the manufacturing sector back where it was in the 90s. But that has to go with attraction of foreign direct investments. Now, certain investments do not come overnight. For instance, I'll give you an example. When MMD decided to open up Kalumbila mine, they went out to look for investors to invest in Kalumbila mine. That was in 1996. It's actually President Chiluba who started the process of bringing an investor to come and run Kalumbila mine. From the time they approached the investors to the time of investment and to the time of actually creating jobs and starting production at Kalumbila mine, it took over 15, close to 20 years. Because first and foremost, when you identify an investor, the investor has to come and do some feasibility study to prove whether indeed the minerals that you are talking about are there. Once they prove, they would want to come up with a process in which they are going to extract that minerals and the way they are going to process the minerals. So there's a lot of planning.
But you didn't have the time.
What I'm trying to say is that we are trying to bring the manufacturing base down, and we've attracted foreign direct investments in a lot of manufacturing aspects. I can tell you that as we stand now, the pledges that we have in terms of investment is about $30 billion.
Pledges?
Pledges, and some of them have been actualized. But the period in which to actualize the investments is not overnight. You have seen that we've created the mouth facility economical zones. The purpose of those mouth facility economical zones, one is in Chambishi, one is at the Lusaka mouth facility economical zone, and one is in Lumwana, is the fact that we are going to offer some kind of tax holiday to manufacturers who are going to come and set up manufacturing industries in those economical zones, such that what we are going to benefit as a country is the creation of employment and also some taxes in form of pay as you earn, and those manufacturing companies that are going to come and set in the economical zones will be manufacturing goods for the entire southern and central African market. But these investors we've brought are slowly coming in after finishing all the procedures that go with investment. For instance, you've just seen that there's an investor who the president was opening up one of the investments which is going to be manufacturing solar, you know, solar energy system. And not long ago, there was another investor who had just set up their company at the Lusaka Mount Facility Economic Zone. In short, we are trying to clean up the mess that MMD left in the 20 years. And you know, where investors ran away, to bring them back, you really have to show that indeed we mean well.
Right,
because
and obviously
once investors run away, like they did in the 1991 when MMD came into power, you have to be very, very tactful to bring them back.
And you're going to use tactics like what, tax rebates?
Not really. Zambians
have that story before.
No.
Once that holiday is over, they transform into something
the
else.
The Mount Economical Zones, the tax holidays that are going, the tax incentives that are going to be given, they are going to be tax-free zones for life. We are not going to give a period. The whole purpose is that these manufacturing companies will have to set up here, and what we are going to benefit as Zambia is the creation of employment and having goods that we can use in our economy that are produced right in Zambia to cut down on costs such as transport, freight, etc., etc. Then they are also going to be exporting these goods to the neighboring countries, attracting more foreign investment in the Zambian economy.
So these are in these new limited setup places called M-phases.
Yes.
Why not turn some places like Cabo, for example, which are relatively dead, you know, in relative terms, if you compare with how vibrant they were in the past, than reinventing the wheel? There's so many places that you could turn into tax-free zones.
You know, frankly, the way you are talking, as if you don't pass through Cabo. Just, I think, 3-4 days ago, the president was reopening Mulungushi Investments. Just about
is it for
a week
political
ago,
expediency?
It has nothing to do with political expedience. You see, that's the problem in Zambia. You think when elections come, government must stop working. It doesn't work out that way. Whether during elections or not during elections, government must continue to operate. And we are not going to be scared of taking certain decisions because people will perceive it as a campaign gimmick. When did we start talking about reopening of Mulungushi Investment? Before Mr. Sata died. And like I told you, to invest, it's not one day. You have to mobilize the resources. You have to do the planning. And it is just coincidence that the reopening of Mulungushi Textiles has come at the time that there are elections. And I think by and large, no government in the world, no government will say, we are not going to open this because it's election time and the opposition and other people may perceive it as an election gimmick. It doesn't work out that way.
That perception doesn't concern you, doesn't worry you?
We are not worried about perception. What we are worried is to do the right thing for and on behalf of the people of Zambia.
This is not artificial.
It's not artificial at all. It's not artificial. I was passing through Cabo today. There is painting there. People are working there. You can see that people have started earning a living from that investment. Next to the Mulungushi investment, there is a shopping mall coming on. That's attraction of foreign investors. There's a foreign investor who's going to put up a shopping mall. Jobs will be created there. Like I said, even that negotiation with that investor did not start yesterday.
Oh.
It started in 2012. And through the years, we've been talking with that investor, and the investor was mobilizing. Obviously, it's not that when you bring investors, that investors have just got ready available money. They also have funders who they need to approach. They need to do a business proposal, which they need to take to the funders in order for them to be funded. So you can see that in Kawe, already, things are happening. The lead mine in Kawe, there's an investor who has come there also, trying to revamp the lead in Kawe. So everywhere, in every town, investment is coming. But these multi-facility economic zones are special tax holiday zones to attract more manufacturing industries for the purpose of us attracting more foreign exchange so that we don't depend on only copper. We'll have a lot of items that will be manufactured in these zones in order for us to kill this thing of once the copper prices drop, then we have very little forex coming on the market. And when we have very little forex coming on the market, our kwacha depreciates. When our kwacha depreciates, the cost of living goes up.
Sam, you may have that well laid out explanation as regards the current situation, but those in opposition feel that you have put the country in such a difficult situation by overborrowing, that this country has huge debt. As at the end of 2011, it was at what, 22 billion? Now it's about what, 48 billion? Have you dealt with this issue wisely? Is it something you will look back and regret having taken?
Franklin, in Zambia, we are experiencing what I may call immature politics. Very immature politics. And politics of not appreciating what others are doing. With the massive infrastructure development that we've embarked on, frankly, you cannot surely fund those projects from domestic resources. It's practically impossible. There is no country in the world, no country in the world, I can challenge you on that, which has developed using their own internal resources. Even at household level, for you to build a house, you have to go to the bank and get a mortgage. You cannot build a house from your salary, frankly, unless you do something illegal, either drugs or maybe you are a thief. But if you are a genuine employee of ZNBC and living by your salary, the only way you can build a house is to go to the bank and borrow. Banks are created for people to borrow. Even the World Bank, the IMF, they are created in order for companies to borrow for development. Now, if companies and countries are not borrowing, they will not develop.
But Zambia has been on this path.
Tell me.
Zambia has been on this path, and it kind of brings bad memories. If you consider what had to be done when the MMD came into power, people being asked to tighten their belts because they had to sort out the debt in which Zambia was in. And it's almost reminiscent, as to, like we've gone back into those times.
Franklin, you must differentiate the MMD period and the PF debt. The PF debt, you can see where money is being directed. You cannot grow the economy. You cannot develop without infrastructure. Unless you want us to be stuck in terms of development for 50 years without moving. In life, they say, if you ever want to know leadership, leadership is measured by the ability to make decisions that will stand the test of time. Let me tell you, a lot of people want to invest in Zambia, and the way to go, like you asked about diversification of the economy, the first and most easy and important sector where we can go as a country is agriculture. Now, if you don't have roads leading to Mpolokoso, if you don't have electricity in Mpolokoso, if you don't have hospitals in Mpolokoso, you don't have schools in Mpolokoso, nobody will invest in Mpolokoso. So as PF government, we took a bold decision to take infrastructure to these rural areas so that we open up these rural areas. Once we open up these rural areas, investment will flow into that. What we are doing, this money we are borrowing is an investment. It's not wasteful borrowing. It's an investment. Let me tell you, these opposition political parties that we have can just confuse you. Look, our borrowing in Zambia as it stands today, as a percentage of GDP today, is just about 38-40% of our GDP. The American debt stands at 410% of their GDP. The Japanese debt stands at 215% of their GDP. If America can borrow to that extent, if Japan can borrow to that extent, how about Zambia? How are you going to develop? In order to develop, you have to borrow. But what is important is that you apply the money that you are borrowing on the intended purposes.
Is that what is happening? Because the arguments, for example, that the cost of constructing these roads in Zambia is twice as much if it were done properly. I'm sure you've come across
those. Those are just stories. These contractors, what we have, are contractors that are in South Africa, are contractors that are in Zimbabwe. We've carried out a survey. We've carried out a comparison. And we have proved that the same cost of doing a road here is the same cost of doing a road in South Africa. The same cost of doing a road here is the same cost of doing a road in England. Like I told you, we are practicing immature politics. Those are just speculations and allegations that cannot be substantiated. Have you ever seen any of these people that are saying we are spending more money on construction of roads in Zambia than they spend in England? Bring even a document from England to show that in England they construct the road at so much money for a kilometer and we are constructing at this. None of them has done that. They just talk when they're on the podium. It is not true. We are not unreasonable.
You're sure people. That you'll not be held accountable one day?
Come on. How are we going to be held accountable? Look, posterity will judge the PF government very well. Because even when they come to pay for these debts, they will be seeing that government borrowed, they built a university in Northern Province, they borrowed, they built Lewanika University in Western Province, they borrowed because they built a road, the Mongu-Kalabo Road. How are we going to be judged, Ashley? Because they will see what they will be paying for, which is different from the UNIP debt. Because for the UNIP debt, we did not see where the money was going. But for us, that's why we are saying Sontapo, we are able to point at the projects where the money that we are borrowing is going. And that is good borrowing.
Has none of this money that you've borrowed gone to consumption? For example, wages and related matters?
Never, never, never. You can go to the Minister of Finance and look at the books of accounts. Never. All the money that we have borrowed have gone for the real intended purpose. And that's why you are seeing these projects standing up. Today, I can walk head up. You see, to travel from Luansha into Mpolokoso, where I come from, it used to take 2 days to reach Mpolokoso. You had to leave Luansha. You go to Ndola, Ndola, Kapiri, Kapiri, Mukushi, Mukushi, Serenje, Serenje, Mpika, Mpika, Kasama. In Kasama, by the time you reach the by airs, those vehicles, open vans which used to go to Mpolokoso will have stopped because they will not move in the night. You have to wait for the... Today, I went to Mpolokoso because we've built a road through the Pedico, a tarmac road, and we've built a road from Mansa into Luwingu. We've built a road from Luwingu into Kasama. We've built a tarmac road from Kasama into Mpolokoso. It took me 6 hours. From Washington, you think posterity will judge us, Ashley, on a project like that? And you think borrowing for such a project that has reduced the cost of an ordinary Zambian traveling from Luansha to Mpolokoso? Because the distance has been shortened up, it simply means that the fare on the bus has been compressed.
Well, the road is one of the projects that you're obviously very proud about. You've also built health centers and schools, but the argument again is, where's the human resource? These are empty shells, just buildings without people working in there.
Frankly, you work for ZNBC. And when you speak like that, my young man, I feel sorry for you. Because you are supposed to be knowledgeable. That since PF came into power, for instance, let's take the education sector. In the education sector, there has never been a time than in the PF government when we've trained so many teachers by opening up new teacher training colleges and transforming some of the teacher training colleges into universities so that the teachers can be upgraded to degree orders to teach in secondary schools. Just like we have upgraded about 215 primary schools into secondary schools. As we are upgrading those, we are also training, upgrading those teachers who had certificates and diplomas into secondary school, senior secondary school qualifications. So we are doing everything that we can to make sure that we've got the human resource to run the schools. Coming to the hospitals, before PF came into power, there was only one university training teachers, doctors, which was UTH. Today, we've got Apex training doctors. We've opened up a medical school at Ndola through the Copper Belt University. We are opening up yet another medical school at Mulungushi University, which will be based at Livingstone General Hospital. So we are taking care of the human resource.
Are you sure that what you wish to have on the ground, rather what is on paper is what is on the ground? Because there are complaints, there are certain health centers that don't have adequate personnel to take care of, the pressures that are taking place in some of these places, especially in the health sector.
That's why I'm saying you that. That's why we've enhanced the training of these health personnel. Just last week, there was an advert in the newspaper where we are asking, people to apply for jobs in the health sector. And I'm sure by now they've started sorting out the papers to employ more people because of the 650 health posts that we've built throughout the country. This issue of meeting the demand in terms of human resource is not going to happen overnight, because training does not take 3 months. To train a nurse is 3 years. To train a doctor is 7 years. So you don't expect that this is going to be done within the first 5 years. That's why we are saying for anybody to want to judge the PF government on the 5 years, it's unreasonable. First and foremost, since we came into office, no doctor that we are training has graduated from the schools. So if you are saying we are not taking care of the human resource, where are we going to take them? Because the doctors that we are training as PF have not graduated. So to judge us on the basis of 5 years, it's unreasonable. That's why I'm saying we are practicing immature politics. Our colleagues in the opposition, if they were genuine, they could have even been patting us on the back to say that people of Zambia, we've never seen a government that has performed like PF. And I think by and large, even if we are opposition, we need to support this government. But for them, their preoccupation is to go into State House to be in government, even misleading the people that they can introduce free education.
Isn't that an attractive idea?
It is practically impossible.
How do you mean?
To offer free education from grade one into university, as they are putting it. It's practically impossible.
Are you not just jealous? Are you not just jealous?
Where are they? How can we be jealous of
a concept that will attract and educate so many Zambians free of charge?
How can you be jealous of something that is not true, something that is not practical? Tell me which country in the world offers free education from grade one to university. Tell me. So if it doesn't happen, how is it going to happen here? Those are semantics and wanting to win the favor of the people through deceit. And they must be ashamed of themselves. Look, the University of Zambia takes in 12,000 students per year. Government only manages to pay bursaries for 1,000 because we are still growing the economy. We have not reached a stage where we can have a free education from grade 1 to grade 12. By far.
Maybe you just don't have a plan to make it happen.
Franklin, immediately after independence in 1964, Zambia practiced free education. You know what happened. By the late 70s, schools had no books. Schools had even chalk. You couldn't find chalk. I used to go to Mpatamato Secondary School where I was the head boy. For you to have a chair where to sit on, we were starting school at 7:30. You had to arrive at school at 5 o'clock to go and scramble for the few chairs and desks that were in the schools. That is what free education did. That is why when MMD came into government, they decided that let's introduce user fees where parents at each individual school were going to contribute something towards the running of that school in order for them to afford the logistical needs such as chalk, such as stationery, such as buying desks for themselves, unlike depending on central government. And I can tell you, I have been in government. If you are going to offer free education from grade one up to university, the entire budget of the education sector, the entire budget of the Minister of Agriculture will just go to run the Minister.
So you don't think this is a good idea? You are not even going to consider it?
It may be a good idea, but it's not practical. It's not attainable. It's not possible.
Could it be lack of talent on the part of your party to be able to handle this?
Not at all, frankly. It's like wanting to squeeze blood from a stone. You never manage. No matter what plans you make, you can never squeeze blood from a stone.
You won't go that direction.
We can't go. We can't mislead the people of Zambia or say that we are going to introduce free education from grade one to university, because it's practically impossible. Our economy is small. We are expanding slowly. We are expanding the economy, growing the economy. At the moment, the money that is collected from the internal resources through taxes cannot sustain free education from grade one to university. Because what is going to happen? Teachers will not be paid. Lecturers will not be paid. There will be strikes all over. So what is the purpose of running something that you cannot afford, which is just going to bring you problems? The best way is to continue like we are doing right now. We do offer free education from grade one to grade seven. And then grade 9, 10, going upwards, you have to contribute.
In the interest of time, let's move on. But I want to take you back to the issue of construction and, you know, the projects that you're doing. At the moment, we notice some projects have stalled. Contractors are also complaining that they're not getting paid. Did you go into a project that you were not fully prepared to go with all the way? Because now you're beginning to disappoint some contractors.
You see, you journalists, that's why I like you. Sometimes you ask a question and you answer it yourself. You asked me about borrowing. You've seen that all the projects that have got the component of borrowed money are going on smoothly. And those projects that are funded by internal finances, those are the ones that have stalled. Because of what I told you already, that we run a mono economy. Everything in Zambia to move depends on the copper industry, the production of copper.
Not that you've misused money, no.
No. It depends on the copper production. Today, the production of copper has gone down. Most of the mining companies have put their mines on care and maintenance because the price is low. Copper prices have plummeted from an average of 8,500 kwacha per ton. They went up to 4,100. It's only in the recent past that they've gone up a bit, and they are hovering on, between 5,000 and 4,800. But that still is too low because it does not beat the production cost of old mines like the Baluba mine at Luansha, like the underground mine at Chingola. To produce a ton of copper at Baluba, to produce a ton of copper at Nchanga, they spend $6,200. Now, if the price of copper is at 5,000, it automatically means that it is a loss. So the reasonable business sense decision that one would make is to put the mine on hold until the price picks up. Because if you invest too much money in a loss-making venture, at the end of it all, you mop up your capital, and then the mine will close for good. That would mean now no more jobs. So the best thing that you can do is to say, let's put the mine on care and maintenance. And by the way, this is not peculiar to Zambia alone. All the copper-producing countries, in fact, not only copper, all the commodities that are mined from underground, the prices have plummeted, including oil. You know that Nigeria is having more serious problems than we are facing because of the low oil prices. South Africa is also facing some problems. Just 2 days ago, I was listening to E-News. The South African economy is registering a negative growth this year. But for us, this year, we are registering 3.4% growth. How can people say?
But you know that this song or the talk about what's happening globally is not going down very well with many Zambians. It's even getting a local... something just being localized, it's global thing.
The problem with people is you want people who tell you lies. People who tell you the truth, you don't like them. But truth does not break friendship. I would rather tell the people of Zambia the truth that we've got this problem because the copper price has dropped, which is a fact. Even if I were sleeping, I would tell you the same thing. But when you are telling lies, within 5 days, you give four different reasons. The truth of the matter is that the Zambian economy is a mono economy. It depends on the mining industry. And because they slowed down in the economic activities in the Eurozone, they slowed down in the Chinese economy, who are the major consumers of copper. They are not buying the copper. And because they are not buying as much copper, the price of copper has dropped. It is a fact. And by the way, in this era and age, you can easily go on Google, find out the price of copper, find out the operation cost for producing copper. In Australia, they've put about 8 mines on care and maintenance. In Chile, 11 mines. In South Africa, 7 mines. In Congo, 5 mines. Here in Zambia, there are only 3 mines that are on care and maintenance. It is the Luansha Baluba mine and the Chingola underground mine and Abidon mine here in Mazabuka. So you can see that in Zambia, we are even much better than other countries. So if somebody says it's not going well with the Zambians, it's because the opposition are full of nothing but lies.
If I'm a miner, then I get concerned. What hope is there for me as a miner? What plan do you have for me as a miner? Any contingency plans, or you have none at all?
I have just told you, the price of copper went as low as 4,100. As we speak today, it's fluctuating between 5,000 and 4,800. So you can see the hope.
So it is to wait on that hope.
Exactly. There's absolutely nothing you can do. You see, when they started retrenchments in the mines, Mopani wrote to us that they wanted to retrench 8,000 employees. We engaged Mopani and we told them, we understand that the price of copper is low and that your operation costs are too high. Please go back and sit with the Minister of Mines, with all stakeholders, and see in which areas you can cut down on costs. They went back, they tried, they did a lot of cost cutting, to the extent that most of the expatriates who were employed at Mopani were terminated. And they ended up only retrenching 4,000 employees from the 8,000 that they were doing. Meaning, therefore, that government played a major role in saving the 4,000 jobs. But Franklin, if you have cancer, if you have cancer on your hands and the doctor says we have to amputate, it's either you amputate or the cancer will spread and you lose your life. This situation in the mining industry was so tense that without putting some mines on care and maintenance, we risked losing the entire mining industry and the future could have been bleak.
What about forward planning? You know that the the mines issue is a very delicate one, which obviously we don't have much control over. One would have thought you'd have gone very big into agriculture, for example.
That's what we are doing. That's what we are doing. I can explain to you what we are doing in the agriculture sector to grow the sector. First and foremost, when we took over, we found the people that were being given FISIP, farmer import support, were only 250,000 people. Today, we are supporting 1 million farmers with FISIP. That's one. Secondly, we've identified areas where we are going to introduce farm blocks. By the way, to go into the farming blocks in those days in the MMD area, it was extremely expensive because you needed some minimum investment for you to be given land in the farming block. But what we have done as PF, we have revised the fees that one needs to go into the farming blocks. And what we are doing in the farming blocks, what we intend to do is that we are going to categorize the farming blocks into a major farmer, a small-scale farmer, and peasants. All of them will be allocated land in the farming blocks. The major farmer, for instance, if he has to grow soya beans, he will have to support the peasant farmers with the inputs, with the fertilizer, so that they can produce and sell to him. Whereas previously, what used to happen is that you only attract the big farmers. Like if you go to Mukosh, you only find commercial farmers. You don't find, small-scale farmers or peasant farmers. But now we want to promote what is known as outgrower schemes, so that even the peasants can participate in these farming blocks, so that more people are able to make money using agriculture, to enhance productivity, and of course, to bring us more foreign exchange.
And this could have happened in the 5 years that you've been in power, surely.
I told you that to attract investments is not a one-day thing. It's in the pipeline. And some of these investments have been actualized. Some of these investments have been actualized. Others are in the pipelines. Others are in the planning stage.
But you are in a situation where you need to be in a hurry. Zambians, many of them.
There is no shortcut in lending institutions, financial institutions.
Oh, so people can just...
There are no shortcuts.
People should just...
There are no shortcuts. You cannot... If, for instance, Barclays Bank has to say you have to produce these documents and it will take 21 days to be given a loan, you're not going to go there, Franklin, and say, because I'm Franklin Tembo, give me in 2 days. They will have to follow the procedure. So even these investors, where they get the money, they have to follow the laid down procedures. And that is why there is you have to do a feasibility study, you have to do a business plan, they have to analyze that, and then fund you. When they fund
and this
you,
has been one of the, and this do. Has been a big problem in this country, the bureaucracy, the long winding methodologies of getting to where you want to reach, when you can do away with paperwork. And now that government has been trying to do that to cut some corners in as far as procurement processes are concerned, for example, don't you think that that's an area perhaps you should have kind of worked on in trying to
That's why I said, when you say that yourself, as a journalist, I get worried. Because in terms of procurement, you know that we have reorganized the government procurement procedures, where now ZPPA is just a policy maker, and that individual ministries can now procure on their own. Previously, procurement was done centrally, and there was a lot of bureaucracy. But to cut down that bureaucracy, we've reorganized ZPPA. They are now just policy. They guide the ministries in terms of policy to do the procurements. The ministry do the procurements. So we are doing everything we can.
But the
Franklin,
but
when you read these online media reports, more especially those done by blocks like the Watchdog, you'd think Zambia is on fire. To the contrary. Zambia is not on fire. Government is fully in control, and we are doing everything to grow the economy. They have said several times that we have failed to grow the economy. Let me give you how we have grown the economy from the time we took over government to date. Let me just give you statistics of how we have grown the economy.
And these impress everybody or just the PF government?
They impress everybody. Look, the average growth rate in the world and in Africa is about 2% per annum for the past 10 years. The average growth rate of all the economies in the world is about 2%. This is how we've grown the economy since we took over government. In 2011, we grew the economy by 7%. 2012, 7%. 2013, 6.7%. 2013, 6.7%. 2014, 5.7%. 2015, 3.5%. And this year, 2016, you even heard when the Africa, the annual conference of the African. ADB, Development Bank of Africa, came into the country. It was emphasized that Zambia is going to grow the economy by 3.4 in the 2016. I already told you the South African economy in 2016 is emphasized to be in the negative. Now, where is the failure? Under very difficult circumstances, we've managed to grow the economy to these levels when the rest of the world are growing their economy at 2%.
The problem
I shudder.
It makes sense to technocrats and, you know, the elite and those that can interpret these economic issues. Not so much the person in Kalingalinga and Chipata compound and the person in the village. These growths hardly make sense to the common Zambian.
To the contrary, if you were moving on a gravel road in Kalingalinga before PF came into office, and today you are walking on a tarmac road, how is it not making sense to you?
Is that person going,
how is it not
is that person going to eat that
first
tarmac?
First and foremost, that is a... You are behaving like HH now. Who was saying, are we going to eat roads? You are behaving like HH. I was telling you how you can cut down on costs. For instance, the taxi drivers that were ferrying people to Kalingalinga, today when they go on a tarmac road, the most likely thing is that they will reduce the cost because they were buying shocks every 2 weeks. Today, they are not spending money on buying spare parts. They can even save enough money to buy another taxi and employ another person. Ultimately, there will be more disposable income going to the people. Those are the benefits. So to say, are we going to eat roads, it's being unreasonable of the worst kind. It's being unreasonable. Look, for instance, I give you a practical example. We've built the road from Mumbala into Nakonde. Before that road, people used to come to Mpika, join the Great North Road. They used to pay 280 kwacha to travel to Mbala, from Mbala into Nakonde. Today, it has been reduced to 40 kwacha because you travel from Mbala onto that road. So when you say, are we going to eat roads, it's being
But other people see, do you think the people appreciate it in that context? Because it's more of a long term, if you look back and then you do the calculations and say, oh yeah, in the last year I saved so much money.
Frankly.
But for the immediate,
frankly,
immediate result,
frankly,
do you think you're communicating well?
Frankly, my younger brother, with whom I'm well pleased, you also has appreciated the PF developmental projects. Let's just take, I know you drive, and I know that you used to drive from Woodlands using Chirimburu or Bama Road going into town. How long did it used to take you on a peak hour like 17 hours to travel from town through Chirimburu Road? It used to take you close to 1.5 hours. Today, from when you join Chirimburu, whether it's around 17 hours, it will take you less than 7 minutes. Because we have a dual carriageway there. Are you not seeing that we are reducing man hours that are lost for people to do other things that can be of economical gain to the country, other than wasting it on the road? So this idea of saying we are going to eat roads is actually being unreasonable.
Does it irk you? Does it put you off? Does it, what does it
do? It doesn't put me off. I just look at people who say that as the people who need to go to Chinama. The people who need to go and be checked at Chinama. Because some of these pronouncements we make, we must first think about them. When I look at people who say that, I think they talk before they think. Every human being must be able to think before you talk. But there are some people who have got a very rare human element of talking before they think. And those are the people who fall in the category of saying, are we going to eat roads?
They can't criticize you?
You have a right to criticize, but criticisms must be positive and reasonable criticism. It must not be based on lies, on unjustifiable criticism. Criticism must be positive, and we welcome criticism if it is positive. But surely, where somebody's telling you, are you going to eat roads? That is being unreasonable.
Does it make you feel that, you know, you are being made to look like you have wasted?
No. You see, if you see a person is not appreciating what somebody has done that everybody else can see, then that person has got a problem. It is just like, I always give this example. If you get 5 men, they go and stand in the corner, and then a very beautiful woman passes, and 4 of them say, this woman is very beautiful. And then only one of them says, she's useless, she's just a bitch. Just know that he must have proposed and the lady said no.
Solid.
That same applies to these guys in the opposition. They have proposed Zambia and Zambia have said no. So they will not appreciate anything that we do. In Bemba they say, ushakutemwa, tatilabu sumabodi. No matter how we are going to develop this country, they will never appreciate. Because they just don't like the PF. Whatever you are going to do to them is wrong. But I think by and large, as government, we just need to do the right thing for and on behalf of the people of Zambia, for whose, on whose privilege we are in government.
Let me take you back to agriculture, because there's a lot of emphasis on maize production, whereas this country has so much potential when it comes to livestock industry, for example, because that is huge. But do you feel it has been exploited? Do you have the capacity, the means, the tact to take this country further and forward using the livestock sector, agriculture, for example?
I like Mpundu Mwape. Mpundu Mwape used to be a journalist here at ZNBC, but I think he works for Zambia, is it Farmers Information Service?
Nice.
And I listen to his radio programs almost every week, and I watch him on TV. First and foremost, we agreed as government to break the Ministry of Agriculture into two. One in charge of agriculture and the other one in charge of livestock. That is a very big political will to grow the sector. That is a very big political will to grow the sector. Today, government has built a lot of deep tanks all over the country to fight disease in that sector. Today, we've constructed about 5 laboratories where to fight disease. For instance, there's one in Solwezi which is being built. There's one in Indola which is being built because we want to fight animal diseases. That is a very big political will to grow the sector. So in short, we are doing everything possible to grow the sector. Long time ago in Zambia, cattle used to be in southern province. Today, if you go to northern province, you find a lot of our colleagues from southern province have moved to rear their animals in northern province because there's better pasture there and, of course, less diseases. And we are encouraging them. We are providing land to them to go into
Isn't that a sector that could have taken care of the headache that you suffer because of the fluctuating prices on the mines and
so on? That's why we are doing all this. We are
still going there.
We are building agriculture laboratories to fight the disease because the biggest problem that we've had with our animal sector is disease. You know that there's been a lot of bans of moving animals from one area to the other because of disease. So to fight the disease first, you have to come up with these laboratories where we are going to be, treating the animals, do research on diseases, and of course, producing the vaccines that are needed to keep our animals healthy.
So full exploitation is yet to happen. To make Zambia, for example, forget about copper because, for example, of the beef industry that this country potentially
We are doing it, but it can never happen overnight. Rome was not built in a year. Rome was not built. And you know, animals, cattle, production of cattle is one baby per year. So the growth cannot be that fast. It has to be given a period. There is no way you can improve on a cow giving birth to 4 calves. It's practically impossible. It will still remain one. Meaning, therefore, if you have got 50 animals every year, which are ready to produce every year, you just expect 50 new ones. You not expect 150 new ones. So it has to be gradual.
Right. So, but is it an area you could have, again, gone into as a matter of urgency upon taking power?
That's what we have done.
Time is up.
The ranches that were closed by MMD, like the Mbesuma Ranch, has been opened. The ranch in Wapula has been opened. The ranch in northwestern province has been opened. Mm-hmm. That's why I'm telling you that we are doing everything possible. What we need is time. for us.
These 5 years has not been enough.
It's not certainly 5 years is not enough. Which country in the world has developed in 5 years? It took the Japanese economy 50 years to grow to the level it is today. It took the Chinese about 30, no, no, the Japanese 30 years, the Chinese 50 years to be where they are. Running government is not akadabra-kadabra. It's not magic.
But you've got opponents that feel maybe they should take over from where you've left and they would do a better job.
In Bemba, they refer to those people as Waputi, Bama Piete. You know what puti means? A person who tells lies. A liar in Bemba is called puti. Those people are just Waputi, Bama Piete. They are lying daylight with their open teeth on issues that they know they can't. I'll give you a practical example. When the load shedding started, HH went on a radio station, Phoenix, and they started castigating us. This PF government has failed. This, we told you, present, and that was about June, July, when we just started experiencing the load shedding. President Edgar Lungu has failed. This is poor leadership. Fortunately, that was a phone-in program. I phoned through Phoenix. Those who listened to it will remember. I told HH, you are saying we have load shedding today because of poor leadership by President Edgar Lungu and the PF. Can you tell the Zambian people five things that you could have done if you were in government to change this scenario of load shedding? Go and ask the young man at Phoenix, or I can challenge them to replay that program. He just started insulting me. Cambridge is a dunderhead. He's an empty tin. You have grabbed the golf club in Rwansha. Your animals are feeding. The young man told him, no, 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 no. What Honorable Kambwile has asked is that give us five things that you do to immediately change the scenario of load shedding. He failed completely. Secondly, no, I'm coming. GBM was on the copper belt, I think 2 months ago. He went and told the people of Zambia that when we come into office, it will take us 2 years to end load shedding. Now, do you know on which projects he was basing that 2 years? On the projects that we are already doing. And these are the projects that we are doing. His boss said, failed to give five things they could have done immediately, but was trying to mislead the people that he was a better manager than us.
These projects that you're talking about, and still staying on the load shedding, since you bring it up, one moment it's about water levels not being being poor. The very next moment, load shedding reducing. Has there been some misleading of people in that in that regard? Water levels, and then water levels haven't improved, but load shedding has reduced. What's been going on?
Excellent question. That's the young man I know in the name of Franklin Jr. Tembo to bring such excellent questions so that the people of Zambia can listen. I have heard people saying they were lying to you that it's the water levels. The water levels have not improved, but because of elections, they have reduced load shedding. Franklin, when this issue of load shedding started, the most immediate thing every government could have done was to import power, right? To supplement the shortage that we had. At the time we went to the market to import power, we found most of the countries that had already started experiencing load shedding, like South Africa, you remember, they had a critical shortage of electricity. They had already gone to Mozambique, who were having excess electricity because they produce electricity from gas. So they had signed contracts with South Africa to supply them electricity. And they gave us the little that they had to supply to Zambia. And we had to wait for those contracts to expire with the South African government and the Zimbabwean government for us to go to Mozambique to import more power. So this time when the contracts came to an end, we are able to import more power. And because we are able to import more power, we've reduced load shedding. But the issue of the shortage of water in our water bodies still remain the same. But we have brought in on board Iteji-Teji, which is giving us 150. And today, His Excellency the President was opening Mamba co-powered power station. So it is not that we misled the people. That is a fact. that everybody, in fact, what we did at Parliament, you saw that when there was that trip, Parliament took some members of Parliament to go and show them, ZESCO engaged members of Parliament to go and show them the water levels at Kariba. When they came back from Kariba, nobody, and I can tell you, nobody, including my talkative elder brother, Gary Nkombo, nobody ever spoke about the situation of water at the Kariba because they went and saw for themselves. So the issue of low water levels in our water bodies still haunts us up to now. But we are lucky that South Africa freed some electricity that they were importing from Mozambique, which we are buying. And of course, Agrenco, also from Europe, has docked some two ships that are producing electricity that we are also importing in the country.
It does look rather convenient, don't you think? Timing and improvement in load shedding. Now you're explaining all these contracts, but to those that oppose you, this just looks a little bit...
That is why I'm calling them immature politics. Because the fact will still remain a fact, whether there are elections or there are no elections. A fact will still remain a fact. And the person who takes advantage of the suffering of others to try and gain political mileage is a devil's advocate.
Shouldn't you have invested into other sources of, you know, power generation?
We have. Franklin, the problem that we have, why we have this load shedding, is because successive governments, that's the UNIP government and MMD government, did not invest in alternative energy sources. For us, we have started. Some of the projects, it's a pity that I left that schedule from ZESCO. Some of the projects that we started will take 4 years to finish. Others take 3 years. Others have taken 7 years, like the Mamba plant has taken 7 years to build. So there's no power station that can be built within a short period of 6 months. Even the lowest, the easiest power generation that you can build is about 1 year, which is the solar plant. So we started experiencing this problem in 2015. And between 2015 and now, we started projects, but they'll take 3 years, 4 years. That is why we have a lot of projects that will come on board in 2019 to give us an extra 2,000 plus power generation, 2,000 watts of power. That is where GBM was basing, because he knows we have those projects and they'll come on board by 2019. So he goes and tells the people to take us 2 years, basing on our projects.
Has this load shedding issue kind of dented your image as the PF? Do you think it has done a bit of damage?
When it just started because of misinformation, yes. But now people have realized that they were being misled. And I tell you, because lies do not last. The truth will always prevail. When this load shedding started, our friends went shopping, the opposition. It is poor leadership. But when we explained, now we sensitized the people have said, this is the truth. And they are now supporting us.
So this
it hasn't dented our image.
So this is not going to change after the elections?
No, it won't change. In fact, it will keep improving. How is it going to change? Today we just brought on board another 150 megawatts from our own production. And in the next 3-4 months, Mamba is also going to bring another, because it's a 300 megawatt plant, it's going to bring another 150. Shortly, the Kalungwishi will bring in something. Shortly, the CEC project in Northwestern will bring something on board. The Ndola Energy will bring something on. It will keep on improving until there will be no load shedding to talk about.
Let's move away from power and maybe move on, because again, our time is really limited. But let's talk about the constitution-making process. Again, it's been very sensitive, and there's issue of the referendum. There are all these mixed messages that are currently having to be dealt with, by people. What do you make of the arguments, especially regarding the voting yes or no with regards to the referendum, where it's now being mixed? It almost looks like this is a PF agenda as against being a national issue.
Immature politics at play. When you have too many under fives on the political scene, you have a problem. I'm sure you and I have never heard so much about the constitution-making process from Edith Nawakwe. I've never heard so much from the constitution-making process from experienced politicians like Rupiah Banda. But these under fives who think today you have got five people coming to eat in Shima at your house, you want to stand as president. You have no structures. You are the secretary general, you are the president. You go and look for a stranded woman, bring her as a running mate. You go on TV, I'm president of UPP. Where are the structures in UPP? In Luansha, I've never heard of anybody who belongs to UPP. In Luansha, I've never heard of anybody who belongs to Mlongoti's
political
party.
Let's stick to the constitution.
Yes, I'm coming. I'm trying to explain why there is this talk forward, reverse, talk forward, reverse on the constitution. First and foremost, what the people of Zambia wanted was the constitution that was going to stand the test of time. Which constitution they wanted to be driven by the people themselves. As PF government, we gave an opportunity to the Zambian people to drive the constitution-making process. They submitted, they met in the districts, they met in the provinces, they came and met at Mulungushi, came up with a document. When they came up with a document, what was important was what is the mode of adoption of this constitution. We said, look, there are only two items that mandatory requires you to go to the referendum to change. That's the Bill of Rights and Article 79 for the altering of the constitution. So we said, these are the articles that do not need the referendum mandatory. We can deal with them so that we don't waste people's time. For instance, today we are going to the elections under the 50 plus 1% because we took that decision. Today we are going to the elections with a running mate because we took that decision. Today, to appoint an ambassador or an AI commissioner, you need him or her to be ratified by parliament because we made that decision. So we said we can do these issues that do not need the referendum, which we take to parliament and bring them on board, which we did. Our colleagues were protesting even in parliament. We want the constitution like today. We gave them the constitution as they required like yesterday. They voted against it. That no, we just wanted to go to the referendum. Why do you want it to go to the referendum? Because after all, when it goes to the referendum, still it will come back to parliament for enactment. And it is not mandatory that you need to take some of the articles to the referendum. So we said, let us do some shortcut that is going to bring the issues that the people of Zambia want. Which shortcut is legal? Legal shortcut. What we did was a legal shortcut because it is allowed by our laws, by our constitution. What we did, there was nothing unconstitutional about what we did. So we brought those issues and amended the constitution. Then we remained with the Bill of Rights and Article 79, which are mandatory that you have to go to the referendum. And we said, look, if we are going to hold a standalone referendum, we are going to spend money on three or four elections within a period of 2 years. What do I mean? Mr. Sata died, we had a by-election. Then 2016, general elections. If in the first round, none of the president gets a 50 plus one, there will be a rerun, the third election. And then shortly, we hold the referendum for elections. My brother, I said already to run government, te pamansansa. You know pamansansa? Pamansansa, filabaitse ukubuta. Te pamansansa.
The argument, though, will be for anything to do with human rights, it might be worth the cost.
Let me drive my point. Running a country, te pamansansa, te kubuta. We have to look at the priorities in the country, in our economy. What are the priorities right now? People need to go to the hospital. People need schools. We need to pay salaries. We need to buy drugs in hospitals. Now, you spend money on four elections when you can combine two elections into one and spend one and the same amount. So we decided that, look, in fact, we didn't just decide and move. We sawed it. We gave the idea to the people of Zambia. Look, what we are thinking is to get these issues that need the referendum, to run the referendum together with the general elections that are coming on the 16th of July, so that we spend only once. If we had held a standalone referendum, it means we're going to finance two elections, two general elections. That wasn't going to be a good decision in terms of managing our finances. But our friends, because they have nothing to talk about, everything we do, they want to pull to the opposite direction. That idea has been overcome by a lot of Zambians, very few. The only people against is UPND and a few Nashala Neka party like Mulongota and others. But the majority of the Zambians have said, go ahead. And for us, the majority rules. But so if the majority have supported us, we'll go ahead and do the right thing.
But if it doesn't get the 50, the required numbers of voters, you will have no choice.
We have no choice.
Right. Okay. That's understood. I suppose we can move on. And for obviously the civil servant is waiting to understand, the issue of salary increments or the lack of it in that regard.
Excellent issue that you have raised again. That's why I say you are my young brother in whom I'm well pleased. This issue of salary increments, people must not forget where we are coming from and where we are going. Because in life, if you don't know where you are coming from, you will not know where you are going. When PF came into government, the lowest paid employee in government was earning about 700 kwacha a month. And as government, we said, look, this idea of giving people 10% this month, this year, 15%, this 2%, let us give the civil servants a living wage that will sustain them for a long time. And we gave a salary increment between 250 to 300%, which pushed the lowest paid person in government to 3 million kwacha a month. At once, when we did this, Franklin, you remember the noise that UPND and MMD made. They condemned us. This government is reckless. How can you increase salaries so recklessly? Where are you going to get the money to increase these salaries? We said we better do it once, and then every year, even if we give 2% or 1%, at least people have got disposable income. So we implemented. They were against it. We were it left, right, and center. If you go and pull the Post newspaper in their archives of what UPND said on the salary increments, you'll be shocked to learn that the same president of the UPND can go and stand on the podium and say, when we come, we'll give you a salary increment. That is hypocrisy of the worst kind. That's hypocrisy. He condemned the salary increments when we gave the workers a living wage. Today, civil servants are able to drive because the salary that we gave them, they were able to go and get loans from the bank and buy vehicles. Others started building houses. We know that with the current economical situation that we are going through, that increment has been reduced. But I think there is no physical space to give more increment in the current circumstances because there is a economical global economical clash.
Or government simply has no money?
No. We it's not that we are broke, we don't have the money. We have the money, but for limited things. We get most of our money from the copper industry. The copper industry is not doing very well. How do you go and increase the salaries when you are not getting the money? Because, in fact, by now, very few donors support salaries. Previously, some donors used to support payment of salaries. Today, We pay all the salaries using the domestic resources. So it is not that we don't want to increase the salaries for the civil servants. We, as much as possible, want to increase these salaries. But at the current moment, as we are going through this financial or economical problem, compounded by low copper prices and low energy, because some of the manufacturing companies that we have are not producing as much as they used to produce because lack of enough electricity. It's also a factor. So because we are not collecting as much money in terms of taxes, it would be very wrong and unreasonable to increase salaries that you are not going to afford.
So what hope
are
you
giving? So we are saying for now, this is a temporal setback. It will come to pass. And once everything comes to normal, we'll give you a salary increment.
There's an opposite, but there is an opposite message out there. One that goes against what you're stating right now.
Which opposite?
Obviously,
message?
That once your opponents come into power, this would be a different scenario.
My friend, these people, first and foremost, have never been in government. For instance, HHH has never been in government. So he doesn't know how government is run. Kanisha's band has never been in government. It doesn't know how government band run. Jeffrey Mwamba was in government, but he was a passenger in terms of financial issues. He was a passenger. He doesn't understand how finances are run at Ministry of Finance. That is why when he was at Ministry of Defense, he gave more contracts to his companies.
You're making allegations. You're not making
allegations. I can substantiate it. I have challenged him before. Let him tell the people of Zambia how much money he earned from contracts in government when he was in government. He has never come out clean. He was a passenger.
You're picking a fight.
No, I'm not picking a fight. I'm only stating a fact. So most of these people in UPND have never been in government. They don't even know how government runs. They don't even know how a budget is formulated. So they'll speculate. They'll talk, no, we can increase the salaries. They don't know. That's what the members say.
Let's move on. Time is, not very good. When the period, and quickly let's get back to the elections themselves, because we're in a time when a lot of people are concerned about the, mixing elections with violence, or violence being characteristic of, this kind of period, which Zambians have been through so many midterms. This seems to be very different. This is not very, very safe for some people. What do you make of the current scenario and the fact that sometimes, in some quarters, your party is also accused of being part of the violence that is going on? Just what are you going to do about this? What are you doing?
PF condemns violence in no strongest terms and with the contempt in which it deserves. Our Excellency the President, Mr. Edgar Chagalungu, has been on record. In fact, as he's going round on his campaign tour, he doesn't end any rally without condemning violence and advising PF cadres to stay out of violence. That does not mean that a few pockets of PF cadres are not getting involved in violence. There are some excited cadres who would want to show that because they're in government, they can do things with impunity. But we've warned them. Anybody who is going to get involved in violence will expel them. And we showed a very good example. There was that unruly cadre who was beating people at the intercity bus terminals. We expelled him from PF. And what did we see? 2 days later, he's a chief security officer for UPND. And he's busy beating people using UPND structures. We have condemned violence. They called the ECZ, called all political parties' presidents to go and sign a peace accord that we should avoid violence during, after, and during, before, during, and after elections. You knew which people refused to sign that document. Our president, despite being Republican president, cut off all his programs and he went and appended his signature. Some people went there with pomp, even pushing people on the doors. When every president went with either their vice president or their secretary general, then they went with cadres. So you see where the violence is coming from. This violence is becoming unreasonable. Where now, in the southern province, for instance, a teacher goes to a rally being addressed by UPND. They just saw that teacher, Udani Mugemba Oja. Automatically, his PF beat her up. She was beaten very badly. That is unfortunate. I have said, and I want to say it again, Southern Province is not exclusive for UPND. Southern Province is an integral part of Zambia. And every Zambian, regardless of their tribe, has a right to go and campaign in Southern Province. Now, if these people in Southern Province can start beating other tribes just because they come from other areas, supposing in Northern Province they also start beating Tongas, supposing in Northwestern Province they start beating Tongas, where is this country coming from? That is why I've condemned tribalism. I have stood by condemning tribalism. Every time I hold a public meeting, I talk about tribalism and the unbecoming tribalism of the UPND. The UPND is a tribal party. Nobody can even question that. When their president died, they had two vice presidents, Sekwiba Skota and Patrick Chisanda. Under normal circumstances, they should have picked one of them to succeed Masoka. They said only a Tonga has to be a president of this party.
Are you not now picking another fight?
No, I'm not picking. Look, I'm stating a fact. It's in public domain. What fight? Ask them if they didn't say that, that only a Tonga can be a president of UPND. And true to their words, they have, you know, the Tongas are not tribal per se. It is the UPND which is tribal, which is telling people in Southern Province that you can only vote for Akainde Ichilema because he's Tonga.
What do you mean? Tonga. Explain that. What do you mean?
What I mean, look at the voting pattern in Southern Province. From 2001, since UPND started participating in elections in Zambia, Southern Province always just votes for a person who comes from there.
So you're blaming the party?
It is the party that has indoctrinated the people in Southern Province to believe that voting on tribal line is the right thing. The Tongas are not tribal by nature, but that party has brought tribalism, and that's why we have a lot of violence. Because everywhere in the world where there is tribalism, what comes out is violence. And unless UPND changes their attitude towards other people, this country will one day go into flames.
We have to close, Honorable Minister. And as you know, as we come to the close, there's obvious you know, accusation, counter accusation about who's finding violence and who is not finding violence. But at the end of the day, it's the voter that you want to wake up early that morning to go and vote. But if he or she is intimidated, then you have issues with numbers and people coming out, you know, and as far as voting is concerned. What should everybody do? What should be done practically to make it safe for people that want to vote to really go out there and vote?
What should be done is to condemn violence and expel anybody who gets involved in violence. And we have done that as PF. Can you tell me if UPND has expelled any of its cadres for getting involved in violence? Look, when we're in the opposition, the police sometimes used to tell us, you cannot hold this rally because of security reasons. We just agreed. We never dared the police. You can go in history. PF never dared the police. One time, when there was that problem at Nchanga mine, they accused Mr. Sata of having influenced the miners to go on strike. They told Mr. Sata, you will not go to the copper belt for the next 6 months. He didn't dare the police. He never went to the copper belt for 6 months. That is leadership. Now, when you see leaders, they are told, you can't do this because of this. They go and take innocent children of other people, not their children, to defy the police order and march to go and have that meeting. Then you see that that leadership supports violence. And this is what the UPND are doing. That lady who died, may her soul rest in peace. The blood must be on the heads of those leaders in UPND.
Honorable Minister, I want to thank you so much for coming to this very special interview. And by the way, you worried that UPND has penetrated your strongholds?
That's the biggest joke of the year. UPND penetrating our strongholds. Our strongholds are not our strongholds by tribalism. They are strongholds by belief in the political ideology of PF. Our president is from Eastern Province, but we are strong in Northern, we are strong in Luapula, we are strong on the Copper Belt, we are strong in Lusaka. Mr. Sata was our president, was from Northern Province. We were strong in Luapula, we were strong in Lusaka, we were strong on the Copper Belt. Some political parties are only strong where the leader comes from. So they cannot penetrate our strongholds because it's based on ideology and the performance of our political party. So it's practically impossible to penetrate those. You see, our friends thought by bringing one person in the name of GBM, you swing the vote in Northern Province. You swing the vote on the Copper Belt. But little did they know that the people of Copper Belt know that in England or anywhere in Europe, if you beat your wife and it goes on public domain, you have to resign as minister. But here in Zambia, a person who beats his wife wants to aspire as vice president. What nonsense.
Honorable Minister, thank you very much. Thank you very much for your time. And I'm afraid we have to close it there. And this has been a special interview with Chief Government Spokesperson Dr. Chishimba Kambwili right here on your national broadcaster. We couldn't cover everything. But it was an attempt anyway to try and cover as much ground as we possibly can. Thank you for watching. I'm Franklin Tembo Jr. Goodbye.